Well, good morning and welcome to Haven Heights Baptist Church. Welcome to those who are here and welcome to those listening online. Just a few announcements here before we begin. The back door will now be open before the service. If you park in the parking lot to the rear of the church, you can now use that back door, so that back door will be open both coming and going. This Saturday evening, we're going to have a youth dinner at the church at 5:30 p.m. It's going to be a free will donation dinner, and it will consist of a pasta bar and lasagna, salad, and dessert. This Saturday, you can come and you can sit back and relax, and the youth will serve you. If it's a nice evening, we hope to eat outside under our canopy so we can spread out. After the dinner, we're going to come inside and we're going to have an auction of baked goods and labor hours. And so if you have a project at your house that you want completed and you have everything but the labor, well, you could be in luck and you could buy some time from one of our youth to come and help you out. So we're going to eat, we're going to have a fundraiser, and then we're going to spend some time praying for the youth. And that's really the most important thing, isn't it? That we're going to pray for the next generation. And so even if you don't have much to contribute, would you just consider coming? I mean, we would just love to have your presence to bless these youth. Some have asked me how much money we're trying to raise to go on our missions trip. So we're trying to raise about $2,000. But again, even if you can't contribute much, we just want you to come and to be a blessing. And if you know right now that you plan to come on Saturday evening, in your bulletin, you can tear off that bottom piece on the back page there, and you can write down your name and how many you plan to come, and that would greatly help us as we plan. Let us now take a moment to prepare our hearts for worship. A call to worship comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, verse 18. This is the words of Jesus. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoned and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Let's pray. Father God, this morning we thank you for the good news of Jesus. We thank you for the good news that you have brought through Christ. Father, we thank you that Jesus has done what we could never do. We thank you that Jesus is the one who brought about freedom from our sins. And we thank you that Jesus brings about sight so that we can see you as the one and true God. Father, we cannot defeat our sin, and we did not have eyes to see you above our lesser gods. We did not have freedom, and we did not have sight, but Jesus did. And in your mercy, you give us such things through him. And so we praise you that because of Christ, we can know your freedom, and we praise you that because of Christ, we can see you for who you are. And so, Father, this morning, we pray for those whom we know, and yet those who do not know you. Father, we think of our family. We think of our friends, and we think of our neighbors. And Father, we pray that you would open their eyes that they might see your Son, Jesus. And we pray that you would use even us, that they might hear of you from our lips, and that through hearing that their eyes might be opened, and that they might see you for who you are. And so, Father, we pray for the preaching of your word yet to come. Father, we pray that your word would go forth from Haven Heights in power. We pray that many would hear of you, and we pray that many would be saved. This day we also pray for those who are hurting. And in the same way, we pray that you would bless the preaching of your word. We pray that through the preaching of your word that you would cause us to see you, and that you would cause us to believe what Jesus has already proclaimed. Cause us to believe that you alone have the good news, and cause us to believe that you are coming again, and that when you come, you are bringing with it a day of no more crying, sickness, or tears. Cause us to believe that there is freedom. Cause us to believe that you can bring freedom from our sin, and freedom from our pain, despair, and anxiety, and countless other evils. Cause us to believe. And we know that belief only comes from hearing. And so we pray that we would hear from you. And in our hearing, we pray for belief. We pray for sight. And we pray for freedom. Finally, we pray that you would use these tithes and these offerings this morning. We pray that these monies that are generously given, we pray that they would further your kingdom. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Will you join us in singing about our Father's world? This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, His hands are wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declares their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear Him pass. He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one.
If you have your Bible, I invite you to turn to the book of Isaiah, chapter 55. Isaiah, chapter 55. The word of the Lord's prophet, Isaiah, chapter 55, verse 1. Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen, listen to me, and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest affair. Give ear and come to me. Listen that you may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promised to David. See, I have made him a witness to the peoples, a ruler and commanders of the people. Surely you will summon nations you do not know, and nations who do not know will come running to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has endowed you with splendor. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and let the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn bush will grow the juniper, and instead of the briars, the myrtle will grow. This will be the Lord's renown for an everlasting sign that he will endure forever. The word of our God.
Stand and sing again. Like a river glorious is God's perfect peace. Over all victorious in his bright increase. Perfect, yet it floweth fuller every day. Perfect, yet it groweth deeper all the way. Stayed upon Jehovah, hearts are fully blessed. Finding as he promised, perfect peace and rest. Hideth in the hollow of his blessed hand. Never foe can follow, never traitor stand. Not a surge of worry, not a shade of care, not a blast of hurry touched the spirit there. Stand up on Jehovah, hearts are fully blessed. Finding as he promised, perfect peace and rest. Every joy or trial falleth from above, traced upon our dial by the Son of Love. We may trust him fully, all for us to do. They who trust him wholly, find him wholly true. Stayed upon Jehovah, hearts are fully blessed. Finding as he promised, perfect peace and rest. You may be seated.
We just sang, they who trust him wholly, find him wholly true. Let's pray. Father, we pray that that would be true of us this morning. Father, we pray that we would trust you wholly. We pray that we would find you wholly true. And so, Father, we pray that you would use these next moments, that we might hear from you, that it might change us, and that we might see you as faithful. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. The kids were all alone while their mothers worked. Many of the fathers had long left in despair. If the kids had any clothes at all, they were nothing more than tattered rags. We were without a doubt witnessing some of the poorest people in the world. We were on a mission trip to the Dominican Republic, and the poverty was simply gut-wrenching. One night, we were having a Bible study, and my friend commented. And my friend said, "These are indeed some of the poorest people on earth." But then he said, "And yet they aren't the poorest of the poor." He rightfully said, "The poorest of the poor are those who are so spiritually impoverished that they don't even recognize their need for God." Spiritual poverty. Spiritual poverty looks like this: I have everything, and therefore I don't need Jesus. Spiritual poverty. I have everything, therefore I don't need Jesus. This is the poverty that the Apostle Paul addresses firsthand. If you have your Bible, I invite you to turn to the book of Acts, chapter 17, beginning in verse 6. We've been studying the book of Acts, and we pick up this morning in Acts 17, beginning in verse 16. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and they brought him to a meeting at the Areopagus, where he began to say to them, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we'd like to know what they mean." All the Athenians and foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship. And this is what I'm going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked off their appointed times in history and their boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out to him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our beings, as some of your own prophets have said. We are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world by justice, by the man whom he has appointed. He has given proof to this to everyone by raising him from the dead." When they heard about the resurrection from the dead, some of them sneered. But others said, "We want to hear you again on this subject." At that, Paul left the council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Demarius, and a number of others. Spiritual poverty. An inability to see a need for Jesus. This world is full of spiritual poverty. And because this world is full of spiritual poverty, it ought to drive us towards four things. If you're taking notes this morning, spiritual poverty ought to drive us to number one, anguish. Number one, anguish. Number two, action. Action. Number three, address. Address. And number four, application. Application. Spiritual poverty ought to drive us towards anguish. Spiritual poverty ought to drive us towards action. Spiritual poverty ought to drive us towards address. Spiritual poverty ought to drive us towards application. When we see those who do not know Jesus, it ought to drive us to anguish. Verse 16, the Apostle Paul, he goes to Athens. Athens is the center of the world in many ways. At least intellectual center. Athens is the place where people go to study philosophy or to study art or to study culture. Athens is the place where intellectuals, where the philosophers and where the professors made their home. Paul goes to Athens and begins to walk around the city, and we notice that verse 16, Paul is distressed. Or your translation might say provoked or even grieved. Apostle Paul, he walks around the city and he sees all of these statues of these gods and goddesses. And these statues actually outnumber the people 3 to 1. That means for every person who lived in the city of Athens, there were 3 statues or more. Paul sees all of these idols and it breaks his heart. His heart is broken because these statues convey that these people have a hunger for God and yet don't know who God is. He sees all their statues and he says, "You guys are hungry for God. You want that. And yet you're ignorant. You don't even know who God is." We're going through the book of Acts. And we're going through the book of Acts so that we can learn how to better share the faith that we have. And this morning, we already see a principle and a simple truth. We're never going to share our faith until, like Paul, we are distressed or in anguish over the idols that we see. We just won't. Until the idols that we see drive us to anguish, we won't tell others about Christ. Now, I suppose you may say, "Well, come on, Lance, we don't really have idols in this country." I mean, driving down Shoup Avenue or Airport Highway, we don't see statues and religious figurines. We most certainly have idols. We're just a little bit more sophisticated about them. As I thought about our idols in this country, I think perhaps our biggest idol, as a nation that is probably athletics. Just think about the sanctuaries that we have to sport. You know, isn't it fascinating that our students go to schools to learn, and the largest room in any school is the gymnasium? It's a sanctuary to sport. And it's the largest room because we know that all these people need to attend, and our attendance conveys this is worthy of our time. Do you know what the most expensive building in the United States is? It's a stadium in Los Angeles, SoFi Stadium. Convey sports are worthy of our money. Do you remember a couple months back? Remember when E.J. Little missed that shot playing for Ohio State in the NCAA tournament? He misses the shot and immediately receives death threats. People are saying sports are worthy of our life. I mean, it's just unmistakable if we're honest. In this country, sports receive our money, they receive our attention, they receive even our lives. Truthfully, it's an example of idolatry. And that's just one of many. We can make politics an idol, or we can make sex an idol, or we can make education an idol, and still countless others. And this isn't new. We know that idolatry is all around us. But let me ask you this, ask myself this. When is the last time it drove us to anguish? When is the last time our soul was troubled for spiritual blindness in others? When is the last time our hearts ached or our eyes were blurred from the tears for those who do not know Christ? You know, typically our hearts don't break. And typically our hearts don't break because we're ignorant ourselves. And we're ignorant to what's taking place in the idol. And Paul is driven to anguish because Paul knows that that idol is never going to deliver. That's what an idol is, by the way. An idol never delivers, and yet the idol demands everything. Never delivers, and yet demands everything. You know, you can think about being stranded at sea here, and hopefully that'll never happen to you. But if you're stranded at sea, the one thing they tell you is do not drink the salt water. If you drink the salt water, no matter how thirsty you are, the salt will dry out your body. And if you begin to drink the salt water, it will dry out your body and you'll get more thirsty and you're going to drink more salt water only to get dried out further. That's what an idol does. An idol demands that we worship it. And we think that if we just give it a little bit more, that it's finally going to deliver. And yet an idol never does. An idol demands everything and delivers very little, if anything. It was fascinating to watch The Last Dance. Perhaps you saw the documentary on Michael Jordan. And in one of the last episodes of that series, Michael Jordan was asked, "Were you a nice guy?" And it was interesting that Michael Jordan became very emotional. And he was pressed, "Do people like you?" And Michael Jordan said this, "Winning comes at a cost." And then Michael Jordan said, "The interview's over. I have to take a break." And what we saw is the greatest winner of all time grappling with this thought, is it worth it? And although he doesn't say it, winning cost him his wife, it cost him his teammates, it cost him everything. And he's grappling, is that worth it? That's idolatry. It costs us everything and yet doesn't deliver. Michael Jordan was in anguish. And in the same way, we ought to have that anguish. Seeing that in others ought to drive us to anguish. And yet, even more than anguish, it ought to drive us towards action. That's our second point this morning, action. Paul, verse 17, he goes to the synagogues, and then Paul goes to the marketplace. And then Paul even begins to debate with the philosophers. I mean, it really is this simple in verse 17. Paul is seeking out anyone who's going to listen to him. It drives Paul crazy that these people are worshiping gods that aren't the one true God. And so he just begins to talk with people. And the Apostle Paul says, hey, don't look to those gods. Let me tell you about the one true God. And what is their response? Verse 18, what is this babbler trying to say? You know, Paul tells them about God. These people say, what is this guy trying to say about God? Like, really? Another God? Like, does this guy not see all the gods we have? If anything, we have too many gods, and he's trying to tell us about more gods, like he thinks we need another one? Isn't this how oftentimes we're heard when we try to tell people about Jesus? Aren't we oftentimes heard like this? Trying to tell me about something else? Like, the last thing I need is one more thing in my life. I mean, we can tell people, hey, you know, it'd be good for you to go to church. And they say, don't you see I don't have time for that? You're telling me to go to church? I have my own things. And what they mean is, I have my own gods. And it's not as though they don't understand our words. It's not as though they didn't understand what Paul was saying. They understood that Paul was saying Jesus claimed to be God, and Jesus lived among us, and Jesus was put to death, and Jesus was raised to life on the third day. But to them, it was just babbling. You know why they thought it was babbling? Because it was so common to them. Paul's talking about a god, and they say, hey, we have all these gods and goddesses. And some of their gods were put to death. And some of their gods came back to life. And some of their gods, almost all their gods, were human-like. And so they say, hey, what are you talking about, Paul? Like, we know about these things. We don't need another. What's the big deal with that? Isn't that our problem in evangelism? We tell people about Jesus, and they say, well, what's the big deal with that? And we tell people, hey, I have found the answer to my problem. And I found my answer to the thing I'm dealing with, and the answer is Jesus. And they say, well, I found the answer to my pain, and it's alcohol. Or we say, you know, Jesus gives me peace, and I'm no longer anxious. And it's true. The Bible says that Jesus gives the peace that surpasses understanding, and I've found that. You know what would bring me peace? A vacation and a good book. You know, Jesus gives my life joy, and I now have meaning, and things begin to make sense for me. That's great. My kids are on the honor roll, and I've got a great job. We tell people we found what we're looking for in Jesus, and they say, well, good for you, because I can find what I'm looking for someplace else. That's exactly what these people are saying. Hey, you think this Jesus guy's great? Well, good for you, because we have countless other gods that are working just fine for us. And yet, they invite Paul to speak at the Areopagus, and they invite him to speak at the council where the philosophers meet. And they bring him before the council, and they ask him, verse 19, what is this new teaching? And they ask him, hey, can you explain this to us? Verse 20, what does it mean? And yet they're not really interested in what Paul has to say. And we know they're not interested because it tells us that in verse 21. They're simply interested in new ideas. They actually invite Paul to speak for sport. It was a Friday night. I walked into a dorm room with some of my newfound friends. We're going to watch a movie, and we're going to talk. I had no more closed the door than one of my new friends said, hey, it's Lance. And then he said to the group, he said, you know, Lance doesn't think that sex before marriage is a good idea. And he said, Lance, why don't you tell these people why you don't think sex before marriage is a good idea? And I remember the scene. Everyone just looked at me. And so I told them. And they were interested. But they weren't interested in becoming Christians. They were interested because to them it was strange. That's what's going on here. They invite the Apostle Paul to speak, not because they're really interested, and not because they're thinking about embracing this God, but it's just so strange. And so I say, hey, it's Paul. You seen this Paul guy? Hey, go ahead, speak. Tell us what you think. Third point this morning, address. Address. Paul takes advantage of the situation. And the Apostle Paul says, hey, you know, if you're going to listen, I'm going to talk. I'm happy to tell you about Jesus. And what a masterful address he gives. The Apostle Paul begins with common ground. He says, verse 22, he says, people of Athens, I see that in every way you're religious. He says, you're religious? I'm religious? You know, we've got that in common. You know, we're starting at the same point. We want to get God right. And he says, hey, as I, you know, looked around your city, I see these religious statues that you have. And verse 23, you even have a statue to an unknown God. You know, I see how precise and careful you're trying to be in your study and understanding of God. You know, it's just like me. I'm trying to be precise and careful in my understanding of God. And yet I notice that inscription. It said to an unknown God. And the Apostle Paul gently backs them into the corner. It's absolutely brilliant. And he says, in your careful study, you actually recognize that you don't know everything. That's why I'm here. I'm going to tell you the thing that you do not know. Verse 24, this unknown God is God. And this unknown God is the God who made the heavens and the earth. And this God does not live in temple built by human hands, as if he's served by us. The God of heaven and earth, he is not dependent upon us. Oh no, the God of heaven and earth is independent of us. The God of heaven and earth, he doesn't need anything from us, but we most certainly need him. Don't you see? He's the one who gives life and breath to every man. And not only is this God is the God who is the creator, but he's also caring. Like, this God seeks us out, and this God is near, and this God can be found. And God made each person in their own time and in their own allotted space so they can seek God. I mean, God placed you here so that you can find him. Don't you see? God made us so that we can have a relationship with him. I mean, our lives aren't accidents, but rather they're a part of God's good plan. And God placed you right here and right now, and he did that so that we can know him. And as some of your own poets have said, verse 29, we are his offspring. That's right, God made us. We come from God. And if we come from God, isn't it kind of silly to represent God as a stone statue? I mean, don't you kind of think these idols are insulting? You know, if we come from God, then God is dynamic and God is vibrant and God's full of life, and we're going to represent him as a stone? That's what the Apostle Paul says. And they invite him to speak, and they invite him to speak for sport. And yet Paul speaks to them. And we ask the question, why does Paul do that? Why does the Apostle Paul just step right up to take one for the team, to get made fun of, to get ridiculed? The Apostle Paul steps forward not as a sacrifice, not as a lamb led to the slaughter. The Apostle Paul steps forward because he knows this is the best message there is. You know, oftentimes we just shrink back from evangelism. We shrink back from telling people about Christ. And one of the reasons we shrink back is because we forget how good the good news really is. And the Apostle Paul says, oh yeah, let me take this opportunity because what I've got is this good. Our message is so full of hope. And our message is what people are longing for. And even if they don't know they're longing for it, they most certainly are. And this is what the Apostle Paul knows. So the Apostle Paul, he says, God is the creator. You know how good that is? God is the creator. That means that there's an intentional design to this world. This world has meaning. You know what that means for us? This means that we exist because the God of heaven and earth decided for us to exist. And we exist because we are a part of God's plan. And because we're a part of God's plan, this means we matter to God. That's so radically different than almost every other system of thought. God is the creator. We matter to God because he created us. Not only is God the creator, God is the sustainer. You know how good that is, that God is the sustainer? I mean, this is wonderful news. God is independent of me. You know, this means that the universe does not depend upon my shoulders. You know, this means that if I mess up, the universe is not going to fall apart because God is the one who sustains it. This means that there's nothing I can do to fail so bad that it's irrecoverable. God is the sustainer. What wonderful news. And obviously, we see that God is therefore good. Like, God's independent of me, and yet God wants to give me life. He wants to give me his best. God doesn't need me, and yet he invites me in. He doesn't need us, but we need him, and so he says, come to me. He longs for us and even draws near to us. This means that God is knowable. It's more good news. God wants us to know him. And God's actually determined our boundaries and our times, and he put us in these places so that we can actually know God. You know, we look at this world and we say, you know, things are so bad, and it wasn't this way when I was growing up, and if only I could have lived at some other time, or if only I could have had some other family. And God says, no, no, no. Don't you see? I put Lance in 2021 in Northwest Ohio. Because Lance, in 2021, in Northwest Ohio, has the best chance to know me for who I am. This is our message. That's a message of hope. That's a message that people are longing for, and a message they're not going to find anywhere else. Like, we have the best and the most hopeful message in the history of the universe. And when we believe that, we'll share it with others. But it's more than simply addressing others, it's application. That's our fourth word this morning, application. We must be driven to apply the message. The people on Mars Hill at the Areopagus, they listen as Paul taught them. And they seemed to enjoy this hearing of these new ideas. And everything was fine. Everything was good. Until the Apostle Paul calls for application. Everything's fine until the Apostle Paul says, okay, now it's time to apply this message to your life. He says, verse 30, in the past, God overlooked ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. Apostle Paul tells these people, hey, you got to change your mind. That's what repentance means. You need to change the way that you think about God. He tells them, you know, God's not simply an idea. God's a person. And God's not really up for debate because God has revealed himself. And because God has revealed himself, and because God is a person, you have to stop living in a theoretical world, and you need to repent, and you need to follow this God. God's not something to simply think about. God's real, and he demands that we follow him. And then he presses in even further, and he says, we've got to get it right, because verse 31, this God will judge the world. And then he says, this judge is Jesus. Paul interjects hope. He says, you know, we know this judge because Jesus came to this earth, and Jesus was a real man, and then Jesus lived among us, and then he died on the cross for our sins, and then he was raised to life again. He says, because of Jesus, we know that this is true. Like, we actually saw him, and these people, they saw him. Like, this is absolutely true, and because it's true, you need to repent. And how do they respond? They're offended. They take offense. I was walking down an Italian villa with my friend. And out of the blue, my friend said, Lance, I think you should be a minister. He said, you know, you seem to be enjoying talking about God, and you seem to read your Bible, and you seem to be interested in these things. And so I just asked him, I said, well, have I convinced you to become a Christian? And he said, well, Lance, you know, my religion is personal. And I respond, well, yeah, you know, religion should be personal, but religion's never to be private. And he said, well, yeah, you know, when I say religion's personal, that means I don't want to talk about it. And he essentially said, we're not talking about this anymore. You know, isn't that the way it oftentimes goes? We tell people about Jesus, and they listen. They say, hey, yeah, that's great, that's great, that's great. Okay, now let's apply it to your life. Yeah, we're done here. That's what happens to the Apostle Paul. We're done here. Some actually, verse 32, even began to sneer. And in their sneering, they're saying things like, hey, you know, God's not just one God. That's crazy talk. Like, we know all these gods exist. And the Apostle Paul, like, you actually think that history is going somewhere? That this world has meaning? No, 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 no. You just haven't lived long enough. You haven't studied enough. This life has no meaning, and there's no purpose to anything. They began to sneer at him, offended. And just like my friend, they halt the conversation and say, we're done here. And yet, notice verse 34. Some believed. Some of the people became followers of the Apostle Paul, which really means they're followers of Christ. And among them are Dionysius. And who is Dionysius? Oh, yeah, that's right. He's a member of the Areopagus. And there's also a woman of great standing. Her name's Demarius in verse 34. You know why this is thrown in? Because it's absolutely true. There before the throne and before the Lamb were people from every tribe, nation, tongue, and language. You know how good this is? Like, we preach and we talk to people who we think want nothing to do with God, and yet some people from that group are going to believe. The most hardened of the hardened, the most spiritually impoverished people in the world heard the message of Paul, and almost all of them sneered. But because of God's great promise that there's going to be people from every tribe, tongue, language, and nation in heaven, we see that Dionysius and Demarius believed. That ought to fuel us to drive our faith with others. No matter how hardened they may seem, God has already told us the end from the beginning, and some of those people are going to believe. Let's pray. Father, this morning we pray for those who are spiritually poor. Father, we pray for those in our lives who see absolutely no need for you. And Father, we pray that you would use us like you've used the Apostle Paul. And we pray that you would use us that many might have their eyes opened and that they might see you for who you are. And Father, we also pray that you would do a great work in us. Father, we pray that you would drive us to anguish, that we might share your truth. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing our closing song together.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumph of his grace. My glorious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name. Jesus, the power they claim the sire, that bids my sorrow cease. Tis music is a sinner's ears, tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin. He sets the prisoners free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood availed for me.
As we go, may we be reminded of the truth of Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. And they were wearing white robes and holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." Go in this promise. Christ has ensured some will believe. And may we share our faith. You are dismissed.